Welcome to Transparency with Zeb King. Today we have a guest that I'd like to welcome on the show, former councillor of North Saanich and also former mayor of North Saanich, absolutely. Ted Daly.
Hi, welcome. Thanks very much, Zeb. Thanks for inviting me. Appreciate it.
Yeah, great to have you on the show. I also want to particularly thank you for coming on the show because you're not a sitting politician at the moment, and it's, I think, interesting for viewers to hear from a person who's been a politician in the past and sort of have a sense of things from a distance, I suppose.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, as I said to you when you asked me, I said, look, I must be old hat by now. Did 21 years for sure, but what the heck is the interest in a washed-up politician? But as you say, I think after 21 years, you've got a few things to offer and some viewpoints to share.
Well, you've already, I didn't know how many years it was.
21?
Yep, 9 in Sydney and 12 in North Saanich.
Wow. I had no idea.
I mean, I must get a medal for that, right? Yeah. Either for stupidity or for longevity or I don't know what. But 21 years.
Well, you're seasoned and you must be quite used to hot potato type questions. I've tried to come up with a few.
Right.
See how we'll do.
I've been seasoned and grilled many times in the 21 years, especially my 6 as mayor.
And so that was how many terms on
So I was 9 years in Sydney and 12 in North Saanich. So 3 3-year terms in Sydney and 4 3-year terms in the North Saanich, 2 as a councillor and 2 as mayor.
Can I ask if you remember back, why? Like, what got you in?
Absolutely. Great question, actually. Yeah. What got me into it was moved here from the mainland and registered my kids for Little League, and they said, do you want to get involved? I was already involved on the mainland, so I said, sure. Before I knew it, I was president of the Sydney Little League, which doesn't exist anymore. And we were going to lose our ball fields, which were at where Mary Winspear Centre is now, because the previous council, when I'd moved here, had approved an interchange for Bat Bay Highway at Beacon. And so we went to the council and said, what are you going to do about our ballparks? And council basically looked at us like, nothing we seem to really care about. So I thought, well, I better run for council. I ran for council, and a lot of people said, you're a newbie in town, good luck. I got on council, and to this day, we've got the finest Little League ball facilities out on airport land. The Pendries were happy to give us some of their lease, and the rest is history. It's a beautiful ball facility. Now, not Little League now, but so that's what got me involved, just something like that.
Interesting, yeah. How it is for each person. I think there's a story there.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And I have to put in this plug. They surprised me on opening day by naming a field after me, and then after my wife died, a couple years after that, they called me up and they unveiled it, and they changed the name to the Joanne and Ted Daly Field from the Ted. So that was really cool. That was nice of them to do that. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, and I know you're retired from politics currently.
I am retired from politics currently, and to put all those rumors to rest, permanently.
Oh, is that right? I was going to follow up with that and ask.
Well, okay. So I now live in Central Saanich. So I'm making a tour of the peninsula. I did Sydney. I did North Saanich.
Yeah.
And I didn't necessarily want to get out of Dodge when I was done in North Saanich. I didn't run for election last time. After my last 3 years, I said that was enough. I had some personal circumstances change my life, so I time to move. So moved to Central Saanich. And of course, as the word got out that Daly's moved to Central Saanich, I run into Jack Maher. I drive right by his fields every day up Martindale and other people. And you're going to run for council? I said, well, I can assure you I'm not going to run for council. And, you know, I said never say never, because when I ran again in North Saanich, and all my fans said, you said you'd never run again. They might remember that. But, no, I'm done.
Uh-huh. So what would you say is the best part of being retired? From politics.
Well, for me now, I suppose the best part is that I've got more me time. Yeah. I'm an avid, I was a slug till my dad passed away 17 years ago, and I took up a bit of a health challenge, and so now I spend a lot of my life up at Panorama.
Yeah.
So it's me time and time to travel. I could tell you I walked the Camino last year. That was 920 kilometers across France and Spain. And I've got three grandkids and one on the way. So that's really the best part. It's time now to spend on myself and my family, especially the 21 years away from family, especially when my kids were younger. So now I can give back and as a granddad and as a dad. So I'm happy to do that.
Right. And I thought about that because you are also currently sitting as a representative to the Peninsula Recreation Commission, yeah, where you had mentioned that you go to work out as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, I think it's important to be involved in your community. And so when I moved to Central Saanich, I was looking for something that I thought might be a good fit, and that came up. And so, yeah, I sit as the citizen representative on the commission for Central Saanich. I'm happy to do that, and I really enjoy doing that. So, yeah, still keeping my finger in the pie in that respect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what do you think of some of the current issues that we face on the peninsula, given you're not an elected politician at present, but
it's kind of fun to sit back. It's a lot more relaxing to sit back from the outside looking in.
Yeah.
And you know, one thing I knew I would never do once I was done is go back in front of council as a delegate. There may be some, let's say, worthwhile cause that I might appear for or something like that, but you know, I think once you're done, you're kind of done. And it's really interesting for me to sit back and look at the affordable housing issue. It just seems to hang around and never get resolved. So I keep a good eye on that, and there's always, of course, the growth strategy now. It sounds
right.
Like we're in for another dogfight there because they're not going to get consensus.
You've been following that one.
I've been following that. Yeah, yeah. I follow it to a degree, but not probably nearly as much as a lot of people 21 years past history would have. I read the paper and I listen to the news, but I'm not really passionate about it as much.
Right.
Certainly not nearly as much as I used to be.
Right.
Yeah.
You're not in the thick of it, so you don't need
to. Yeah, exactly. And it's nice not being in the thick of it, you know. And I sort of keep on top. And then more locally in Central Saanich, I know the revitalization, Brentwood Bay, and they got the drainage issues and things like that. And I know Central Saanich is doing some sort of open houses, some townhouses, you know, for the public to come and address them. So there's some good things going here. But, unless you guys really buck me, I won't be coming in front of you to speak at public participation.
Well, let's see if this question gets
okay, you're setting me up.
Okay, so what do you think of the unelected airport authority board deciding to build a shopping mall to raise revenue? Apparently, it's about annual revenue raised for this is equal to 18 cents per traveler.
Yeah.
From the airport.
Yeah.
Is that an issue that would trouble you? Or?
I've got lots of thoughts on that. So they're unelected as far as the airport authority and the residents, but they are a board, and their purpose is to run the airport authority, which means managing the property they own and the revenues that come in. And obviously what they're looking at here is they need to generate revenue to run the airport.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I guess it's like if you were sitting on council, which hat are you wearing if something comes in front of you? So, you know, they may have their own personal opinions as to whether or not they think it's good for the peninsula, but if they're sitting there as a board member of the airport authority, they should be sitting there to make decisions in the best interest of the airport authority. So, I've certainly got opinions as to whether or not I think it makes sense there, but I see that as their mandate. So, you know, now the thing is, in North Saanich with the Sandown thing and in Sydney with the Gateway thing, those councils obviously have a lot of say and control over what happens. So at the end of the day, I'm not so sure Gateway could happen without Sydney's consent. So, you know what I'm saying? Am I making much sense there?
Well, in a sense, I've been interested in this issue, this story, because each municipality has its own official community plan, and you mentioned a regional growth strategy, et cetera. But those are really for municipalities to deal with. And here's an airport authority, again, not elected, that can go ahead, I guess. And you've mentioned, maybe they couldn't without Sydney, but...
I'm not sure they'd do the gateway thing if Sydney Council wasn't on board. I mean, maybe they could, but I'm not so sure they would do it if the council, because they want to remain good neighbors as well. So I would have encouraged Sydney Council, and certainly North Saanich Council, but I wasn't there at the time, to do what Langford did and just say, you know, this is all, you know, so now Langford doesn't have to go down to the CRD cap in hand for anything they want to do, because they basically said, this is our development area. It's, it's all within the urban containment boundary. So it became certainly very problematic for me, especially as mayor, because I got elected on a platform that I wanted to do X, Y, and Z, but it was basically, it was my counterparts down at the CRD who basically, you know, had the hammer at the end of the day, because I had to go down and, you know, it's fun to look back. It's fun to look back, and I certainly, the things that, that, you know, that I wore and was personally attacked for, I wouldn't have changed any of them, but I would have done them differently. And that's something on reflection. And to give you an example, I tried to bring in this idea of
village centers.
Village centers. Village centers. I still think it's an amazing idea.
That was in North Saanich.
And I think it's been done by the Deep Cove in North Saanich by the market there, because at the time, if you wanted a coffee, you had to go to the gas station, buy a coffee at the gas station, and sit out by the pumps to drink it. What Deep Cove Market has now done, and they've expanded the services there, and now it is kind of a village center, because the Deep Cove Market is a happening place. I think the village centers was a good concept, but I'm not a very patient person, and I think I could have done a much better job directing staff and rolling that out, and if I was more patient, maybe it would have been successful. I don't know if it would have been, but I think it wouldn't have been blown up to what it was, that Daly wants Costco on every corner, which of course I have no desire to do that.
And I think it was, there was, if I recall correctly, about 800 people that turned out or something. I remember reading it was a large number of people that came out.
It was huge. And I see a lot of them. It's funny. I see a lot of them. I saw a couple of them today up at Panorama. You know, the nice thing about it, at the time, I've got to say, and I think a lot of municipalities may be like this, and there was, you know, you saw recently in the paper about this councillor mayor who's not running again because of the sort of the personalization, the attacks. There was a fair amount of that, you know, and I see a lot of these people now, and, you know, I think we're okay. I think we go, look, but at the time, I think I really was, mischaracterized. I really do, you know, and, but put my impatience to get something done on top of that, and, you know, it was sort of a perfect storm for people to say, let's run this guy out of town. That's another interesting thing about, you know, local politics. I mean, I got elected as mayor twice because I got the people out to vote. But then they disappeared because they basically say, well, we got you elected, we did our job, now go do your thing. But so you don't likely see them for the next 3 years in a three-year term. But you see the people who didn't want you to get elected. And so what you're seeing at council from the presentations and stuff is mostly people opposed to your view. And I accept that, but it's, then it paints, I think, a bit of a distorted picture.
What I think is fair to say is that it's during at least some of those years on North Saanich Council, you were on council during a fairly polarized...
When I came here and we started this Little League thing, and I had to go to North Saanich to ask if they would install the water without charges, whenever people are going to me, if you're serious, give your head a shake. You can't get anything done in North Saanich. They're not going to give you a thing. And then, but talk about the division and the polarization. From what I was told, that's been going on there for years and years and years. I don't know if it was ratcheted up a couple notches when I went there, because rookie me, so after my first term on Sydney Council, when we're at the all candidates meeting for next term, I mean, I decided to challenge some of the other councillors who are running. And I came across as an ass at the all candidates meetings, but the all candidates meetings were so boring anyways, it certainly livened it up. But you could go back and find some articles on that. It was pretty, I was going, that person does this and that person, why are they doing this? And I was an ass, you know, but I was young and I thought, well, we'll spice it up a little bit. It spiced it up, I got elected, but as did the people I was taking shots at, so it made it uncomfortable for the first couple of months. But, you know, that's not really me. I mean, I'd still have to convince some people more Saanich than I'm sure, maybe even Ed. It just seemed to be issue after issue in North Saanich. So when I was running the first time for mayor, it was the sewer issue, mm-hmm. you know, and that was like, because, you know, in North Saanich and probably a lot of communities, sewers equal development. If you don't have sewers, you don't have development. So when I'm saying we need sewers to clean up, you know, the effluent that's running in the ditches and on the shore, they're going, and they translated that by saying Daly wants sewers for development. Well, it was not even remotely close to the truth, but that's because I was the developer from Sydney, right? So sewers was an issue, and then Sandown was an issue, and the village centers were an issue. There's this issue after issue, but, you know, I went in there, I got elected, and I basically was attacked for trying to do what I said I'd do when I was elected, when at the all candidates meeting. So often politicians will say what they want to get elected and then you won't see anything remotely resembling that. So I got attacked for doing exactly what I said I'd do at the all candidates meeting. So that was the tough part. And then for both terms, I was on the downside of a 4-3 vote. So it was still, as mayor, I was elected. That's my, you know, this is what I tried to do. Nothing could get done. And again, my fault because of my nature and you know, not very patient and probably could have done a better job there, then things just blew up.
And so you didn't actually run in the last election?
No.
Have you lost an election?
Yes, I lost. I lost two elections. I lost a by-election, and when I lost the by-election, I basically, at that time, said I'm not running again because I'll get into, I don't have a thick, my skin isn't nearly thick enough for this business. So in the by-election, one councillor from North Saanich moved and one passed away. So there were two seats, there were four of us running. I was the only one with municipal experience and I came last. And I came last because I said we should ask the people and talk about amalgamation. Oh my God, Daly wants to amalgamate. No, I didn't say that, but that was the message. So I came fourth out of four. So after that, I thought, nah. Now, I was on Sydney Council at the time, but had bought property which we built on and moved to a North Saanich. And then I lost the election when I ran mayor the third time to Alice Fennell.
You know, the reason why I ask about a loss of election, I've lost elections before. I can think of back to high school, the university election, and a municipal election. I think it's important that politicians and maybe former politicians as well, talk about those elections where they lost too, because I've found that you learn even more from those elections where you've lost than you tend to when you've won, because when you win, you just carry on, of course. When you have a loss, you kind of sit back and think, whoa, what happened?
Yeah, I was, I going into my then third term, running for a third term as mayor, I certainly had no illusions or no preconceived notions that there was going to be a cakewalk. Not by any chance, because North Saanich is North Saanich, and people, of course, right after the first day after the election, is wait for 3 years from now. So I certainly no notion that it was going to be easy. It was relatively close, but I lost, and I took it hard because, you know, first of all, my kids came out and support the old man, and they I know they didn't really know how to react, and it was tough, and it wasn't, oh my God, I've lost my seat, I'm not the mayor. It's like, wow, I mean, I guess, and did people feel that way for 3 years? You know, it's, you really start to go back and reflect, and but I take things way too personally. So I took it way too personally. But certainly, you know, when I lost as mayor, and that's when I started reflecting on how maybe I could have done things differently, like the village centers. Although I'm not convinced, even if I'd done that slower, differently, that I still would have got it done in 3 years. And that's where I'm impatient. I think 3 years is lots of time.
Right. So, and thinking back to those years when you were on council again, and thinking of North Saanich and its culture, I guess its political culture, and what we were talking about that polarization, is it fair to describe it the way some people do, is there's a pro development and an anti-development side, or
you know,
and I mean because my understanding was that and you were on the pro-development side.
Right.
Would you characterize yourself as
no, that? Not at all. But I wouldn't. But I'm certainly more pro than the three who worked. But I wasn't as pro as people who clearly were pro-development. I mean.
But were you weren't the leader of the Team North Saanich or some?
Well, at one time when I ran for council, I ran with, I ran as a team, but no, that team, I wasn't even on that team. See, that's the funny thing about it.
Oh.
So there was that team, and three of them got elected. I was never on the Team North Saanich, never. But three of them got elected, and three other who formed loosely formed a team because they realized they probably had to. And then I'm in the middle. I mean, I could have been, you know, kingmaker or whatever, you know. Okay. So basically, I was it. But you see, so what really frustrated me, not only with the time on council where there were three and three, and when I was a councillor and Alice, the current mayor, was the mayor, or when I was the mayor, in my real job, I was in sort of mediation, arbitration. I mean, I was a management rep presenting arbitration stuff, but my career, 20-some-odd years, was resolving issues with unions and resolving grievances, and I was very good at it. And some of the leading arbitrators in BC, Vince Reddy and Stephen Kelleher, they actually endorsed me one time on my campaign flyer. So that's what really frustrated me. I knew I had the skills to do this, and I couldn't. Mm. And I just couldn't make it work in North Saanich. So that's, I think, what frustrated me more than anything, that I just, those skills I had and I knew I had, I just still couldn't bring.
I hear that, because, I mean, with the past council where Team North Saanich was there, I think there was somewhat of an unusual level of activism from the community as a result, and none of the...
Yeah, they got wiped out.
...were elected.
they got wiped, you know, and... So the big issue there was then where we're looking for an amendment to the regional growth strategy to bring in some smaller lots. For instance, the lots across from the airport, wedge, which I think and still think North Saanich badly needs. And I go, how does that affect the rural nature of North Saanich? Come on, it's under the, you know, it's by busy McTavish Road, it's under the airport, you know, runway or, you know, flight pass. But certainly... that became a big issue, and it got really contentious, and the whole team was wiped out. So I think it's fair to say, because people were saying the real answer as to whether residents want it or not will be at election time, and they all got defeated. So, you know, you have to accept that. So I think that's residents saying, no, we didn't want to do that, you know.
Hmm.
Although I still truly believe that North Saanich needs that type of housing, as does every community.
Interesting. Yeah. No, you haven't changed your views. You present what your views are, and if people accept them, then fine. If they don't,
so that's why. Again, it disturbed me. When I say disturbed me, and I was saying my skin isn't thick enough for this. It's not. I mean, personal attacks, and my skin isn't thick enough for that. But that's why. But I found it more disturbing that during my election campaign, I said, "Here's what I want to do: balanced approach for a balanced community." I want to see smaller lots, I want to see starter houses, affordable houses, I want to see houses for older people, and do that in the community. I mean, our community is North Saanich, it's not Sydney, and the argument was, no, that's what Sydney's there for. I'm going, but no, we're a community. So But when I tried to do that, I don't know why people were so mad. I said, in my election campaign, I said that's what I was going to do. But interesting years on North Saanich Council.
And how would you say you've helped the ordinary resident of North Saanich or Sydney?
It's a great question, because to be honest with you, when I walked the Camino last year, one of the things I needed to resolve was, did I let the residents of North Saanich down? And I gave a lot of thought to that. But I think we you get caught up with the contentious stuff, but 95% of the stuff that council does is done probably with unanimous votes, right? So, so there were a lot of things that we did in the community, one of the things we did there, we brought in a flag. We never had a flag in North Saanich. We didn't have an identity. And it's still there today, and that's cool. I think, something like that, bringing the sewers, I think, though, was the biggest thing, because, we were able then to clean up the ditches and clean up the beaches, and as much as the people didn't, there were, a group of people that wanted them, I think bringing the sewers, was huge. And the housing that we did get in, it sold like that, and you see, trying to get younger families in. So, I think, looking back, I'm happy with what was done, but I think more could have been done, and goes back to if I had been patient enough. Certainly more could have been done if I had a majority on council. There would be no question about that, but I didn't. Right. So that was the reality of it.
I can anticipate the answer to this question. What advice would you have for the current council members?
Well, of course, I think the ones I'm probably more comfortable in answering that question, advice to people who are thinking about running, because you certainly need support at home. And so when my wife was alive at the time, my kids were only 6 and 8, but it was that ball fields, and these are our kids, and where are the kids going to play ball? So my wife was very supportive, but the piddly little stipend we got at the time, basically the deal was that stipend will pay for sitters when I'm not here, or mostly a housekeeper to come in and push that vacuum and, do some window cleaning and stuff because I wasn't going to be there. So that's one thing. You really need the support at home. The other thing is, if an average council meeting is 3 hours long, I would say, 4 times that for the preparation you're going to have to do for that council meeting. And, it gets easier as you go along. But don't think all you have to do is go to the council meeting, that's all there is.
That's really good.
The preparation time, especially when you're new, right? Because you don't want to look like an idiot, mm-hmm. right? So you probably over-prepare. So it's a lot more than just what you see now, fortunately, on TV or if you go to the meetings.
Yeah.
The commitment to the public, the community events is huge. And you've got to take that into consideration as well. But you really have to want to do it. If, they say you shouldn't be a one issue, I could see, I got involved because of Little League. I was a one issue guy when I ran, but then it got much bigger than that. So I think it's fair enough to run because you've got an issue that you just feel strong enough you've got to get on council. But certainly as soon as you're elected, you've got to look at the bigger picture, which includes looking at everyone's opinion on both sides of the argument. Yeah. But I, certainly when I started, I'd no idea what the time commitment is, and then if you go a notch up to mayor, huge commitment as far as the public stuff, right. Which I miss, frankly. Right. If I look back, probably the best times I had was representing the municipality at events, and like when they do the changeover at the Air Force, at the Hilo Squadron and at the cadets and things. I probably miss that the most. Yeah, absolutely. Because I'm a bit of a schmoozer. So I miss my calling in life. Maybe 21 years that I spent on, I should have been just schmoozing people. I'm a professional schmoozer.
There you go.
What can I say?
Well, Ted, I really want to thank you for coming on the show.
Some great questions, Ed. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ed. All right. Thanks very much.
That was great.
Yeah.